church.
Good morning.
As I look down, I am a little bit nervous because today the church is a little bit cooler than what it normally is.
Amen.
Anyway, I thank God for this opportunity to share. In May, last month, when I was asked to preach, I had this topic in mind. Unfortunately, at that time, Sister Miriam was getting baptized, so I was not able to preach my sermon. And so the opportunity has come back up again, and so praise God for this opportunity. I wear different hats, and it's been a very busy week for me. But when I saw the date that was given to me last week, I was also coughing really badly. In fact, I finished taking the antibiotics yesterday, so please bear with me. I believe that this message is a message that God has put in my heart to share, and it's timely for our little church. So before I share, I'm going to say a word of prayer. I thank you. Sorry, I forgot the name. I forgot Tanya. Sorry, I forgot Tanya's name, but I am going to pray again just because I just want extra confidence from God as I stand here and preach His word. Let's pray. Oh God, our kind and merciful Father in heaven, thank you so much, Lord, for this opportunity to present this message. Lord, I'm an instrument, I'm weak, and Lord, I ask that this morning you hide me behind the cross as I share your message. And Lord, I ask that people who are sitting here in this audience can be receptive to your word. Help us, Lord, to refocus in our lives, to be served, to work together to finish your work on this earth so that you may come soon. Be with us now. Bless each and every one of us, we pray in Jesus' worthy name. Amen. So for those of you who don't know me, I usually would like to tell everybody who I am. My name is Dulcie, and I'm originally from Port Canal, a little island in the Solomon Islands. My family and I, my husband and children here, we came from New Zealand 2 years ago. So we are like 2 and almost 3 years here now in Brisbane. I believe, as I said, this message is timely for our little church. Some may find it sensitive, but for me personally, I think it's important for us to hear this message so that we can grow as a church. As a practical person, I always want to share on topics that has practical implications for our church and how we can improve as church members as we wait for our Lord's soon return. Also, further on this message, there's going to be a part that I will require the audience to participate. So when that comes up, I'm going to ask my husband to just go around and share some pen and papers. The topic, as you can see, is on the board, is on cultural identity and a sense of belonging. I chose this picture purposely because I think it reflects people who come to this church. Beautiful young people. So what we are going to cover this morning is the definition of culture, a sense of belonging, and its importance, barriers to a sense of belonging. What is Jesus' identity and culture? Murri-Wantok Church as a church, and what is our identity, and what needs to change? And then I'll draw the conclusion. As people of ethnic background, and as First Nations people of Australia, we all have identity. Usually, our identity would have connections to our land, our family of origin, countries of origin, and our culture. I really like the way, having come from New Zealand and having lived there for many, many years, I really like how the Maori people would introduce themselves and they stand up to speak each time. It goes something like this. The person's name always comes last. They talk about their family, their land, their river, their mountain. It identifies who they are. And they would also talk about which marae they come from. It gives meaning. Identity gives meaning to who we are. It is the basis of how we navigate the world in which we live and the world around us. So, identity, what does identity stem from? It stems from, as you can see there, how we are raised, our traditional practices, and also from our social, our exposures to the social environment around us. It's not always positive, there are also negatives around it, but those things help to shape who we are. There is a saying that sometimes I hear people say, you are what your grandmother is, and it's true, isn't it? On a sense of belonging. Abraham Maslow, an American psychologist, categorically places a sense of belonging as the third most important need of a human being. As human beings, it gives us satisfaction to be connected to other people in the form of different relationships that we have. We belong to some place and we feel that we connected intimately with. As a saying goes, no man is an island. Researchers have shown that social isolation is a cause of stress and anxiety to a lot of people, especially the vulnerable people like the elderly, and those who live with some form of disability and are less able. Also, in those... those people who have relationship with other people, research have also shown that they tend to thrive and have a better life. Have you ever walked into a place? This is a question that I want to ask that I was talking about. And I'm going to ask my husband to share some pains and pain, and I want you to jot it down because I feel that this is something important for us to think about and to write down things that we want to see change. And the question is, have you ever walked into a place and feel that you don't belong? Or worse still, walk into a church and don't feel that you belong there? I want us to think about this, and I want us to think about and say, what are some of the things that makes us don't feel belong, especially in church? That is the first question. So can you just give papers and can you put your hand up if you want a paper and pen, please? This will be brought to the attention of the people who, I mean, in this church, so that we get to know and we deal with those sort of things. I want us to think about and say, what are some of the things that make us don't feel belong, especially in a church setting like ours? And I also want to say that please be honest, because we do want to know so that we can make sure that it doesn't happen in our church. What are some barriers to a sense of belonging? like to give you like 2 minutes to do that before we move on. And please hold on to that paper and pen because another question is coming up. Next question. As you can see there, it says, what can? What will encourage a sense of belonging in a church setting? Notice that I do mention church, but there are also other things that we can do. When you're done with writing, can you put up your hand so that my husband can come around and collect them? It will be used in the business meeting when we have that. Thank you. Can you put up your hands? The next thing I want us to have a look at is, what is Jesus' identity? And I specifically intentionally didn't put this text up on the screen because I want us to open our Bibles to participate when we come to church and we sit back and just listen. We tend to go to sleep. We don't really participate. So, the first text that we will look at is found in. So we are going to identify who Jesus is. It's not that we don't already know, but it's just to reiterate who he is to us. So let's look at Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15 if you have your Bibles with you. And I'm going to ask, I don't know all your names, so when I point to you, it's your turn to read. Jason, do you have Genesis chapter 3 verse 15?
I will put enemy between you and the enemy, and between your seed and the seed, and their seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel.
Thank you. Can you hear Jason? Okay. The next text to read is Isaiah 53 verses 5 to 8. Can I ask Tabu, Sadie, can you read Isaiah 53 verses 5 to 8?
Laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet
and as a sheep before its shearers is saddled. So he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken.
Thank you, Sadie. So those two texts basically talk about, Jesus' coming was prophesied in the Old Testament as a God who is going to be born to this earth to save us from our sins. Auntie Faith, can I ask you to read Matthew 1, verses 21, please? So again, it seems like this in this quarter's lessons, we were talking about the Old and the New Covenant. And it is in the New Testament that Jesus has come to fulfill what has been prophesied about his coming. So that kind of, there are many more texts that talks about his coming, but those are some of the texts, a few of those texts that validate Jesus' coming and his mission. To this earth. What is, the next one is, what is Jesus' culture? Genesis chapter 3 verse 16 talks about Jesus again coming as the sacrifice to save us all. Can I ask, Glenn, do you have John, Gospel of John chapter 3 verse 16, please? And I'll ask Mila to read John 15 and verse 13.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Thank you. Mila? John chapter 15, verse 13.
Great the love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's.
So we basically see Jesus' culture, and it's all about love. When Jesus was here on this earth, he showed us how we can live our lives as Christians. And it's basically to serve. Jesus, when he was here on this earth, he was always among the most vulnerable people, the poor, the lame, the blind, the lepers. He basically lived amongst those who were rejected. And church friends, Jesus lived an exemplary life of service that we ought to follow. He did not own a single thing on this earth, as is found in Luke 9 and verse 58. Can I ask Tanya to read that? Luke chapter 9 verse 58. We focus so much on the things of this world that we give very little time to focus on the mission that Christ has commissioned us to. Can I please ask one of those lovely ladies at the back to read 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15.
Um,
I remember Maria. Maria, can you read 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, please? Yes.
Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him.
Thank you for reading that text. While Jesus' mission on this earth is to love and to serve, one of the warnings he gave was not to love the things of this world. Sometimes we focus so much on the status of who we are. We focus so much on being recognized. We focus so much on things that we want to be, to have status and recognition of this world, like I said, and we totally forgot who our focus should be on. This is a warning to us. It says, if we love the things of this world, heaven is not ours, because we don't prioritize God's mission in our lives. So it comes to us this morning as a warning. So, coming back to our church, what is Murri-Wantok Church identity? We have a common mission. We have some common denominations. We claim to be Seventh-day Adventists who are followers of Jesus, who claim to keep the commandments of God and have the spirit of prophecy. That is the ideal identity for Murri-Wantok Church. What is the culture of Murri-Wantok Church? Can we confidently say that we have Jesus' culture? Are we kind? Are we loving to people that come through our doors? Do we have a social training? If something happens in this building, will people around us know who we are? Will they come to our aid? It is something for us to think about seriously. Because if we, like we talked about this morning in our lesson, if we are only coming to church because we have other reasons to fellowship with other people, or we totally miss the focus of our worship, which is Jesus, and not living the life that we should be doing, what we should be showing to people around us, we will definitely not inherit the kingdom of heaven. A greatest commission in the Bible, as Jesus shared, is found in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. Let's turn to that text. Matthew 28, 18 to 20, and let's read those verses together. So if I can start and then we'll all read together. And he said to his disciples, the authority that was given to him, and that is given from heaven, all of heaven he has authority as well as on this earth. And then he commissioned us. He said, go and tell people about who I am. Do we love Jesus enough to be doing his work and waiting for his soon return as he commands? Are we so busy with the worldly wealth and even very little time to do his mission. This week, as I was reading these texts, two stories stood out for me. Last month, two very young people died in the Solomon Islands from bomb blasts. Those bombs were from the Second World War, but they were not detonated. And this group of young people from our Seventh-day Adventist Church, one of the biggest churches in Coney Island, were fundraising. And they were doing cooking under a mango tree. Unfortunately, they were doing open fire cooking, and it was directly above the bomb that was under the ground. So one of the bombs detonated, and unfortunately, two of our young people died from that blast. One of them, while they both loved the Lord, one of them was a 29-year-old. He was an inspiration to me. When they held his funeral, the church was full to mass. The government dignitaries were there. The diplomatic mission representatives were there. The government officials were there. He was 29 years old. But he lived a life of service for Jesus. Every time a church task is given to him, he never delegates. He would say, it's God's work, I'll do it. He never delegates. That should come to us this morning. When God's work is given to us, we should not be looking for people to pass that task to. It is our job. God has seen who we are, our talents. Our service for him is to do those work. In this church, sometimes we find excuses. We always rely on Pastor Luke. And you know, there are also elders like Cliff, Mila. They always do all the work. Why is it that we're not taking those responsibilities upon ourselves? Who are we as Christians in this church? Are we here to serve Jesus, really? Are we full-time Christians, or are we only part-time Christians? We need to seriously think about these things, because the Lord is coming, whether we are ready or not. Are we doing his mission? Are we proclaiming his message to people to know about him? I think those the Gingy work that is going, it's part of God's work, and I thank you very much for sharing this morning. See how God works in a very curious way. I didn't know that we were going to share the work, but it is aligned with the message that I'm preaching here. This young man that died lived his life for God. And although he was only 29 years old, the work he did could have been done by a 50-year-old or even a 70-year-old. What are you doing for Jesus? What aspect of your life are you committing to God's work? It is something that we need to seriously think about. The other story that came to my mind is the story of Ananias and Sapphira. You know, it's a common story about these two people who promised to give the money that was sold from their piece of land to God's work. And in the end, once they sold that piece of land, they loved the money and they kept a portion of it for themselves. God is not asking us for money. He's asking us for our time. Are we like Ananias and Sapphira? We wanted to do, we have been asked and we put up our hands to do something and then we don't do it because we have so many excuses. We are not focusing on God's work. We need to think about this. Let's read Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21. Can I ask Shay to read Matthew chapter 7 verse 21, please? Right. Matthew 7 verse 21.
Lord shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that goes
Amen. And therefore Jesus saying, when Jesus comes, we always say, but Lord, we've been worshipping at the Murri-Wantok Church. We've been going Sabbath after Sabbath. He said, in the text that has just been read, not everyone that said unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. What is our task that we should be doing for Jesus today? You know, when Jesus was here on this earth, he called the 12 disciples to be his followers and his messengers. They were fishermen. Sometimes our excuse is that we don't have the talent. We cannot speak in front of people. The same goes, Jesus does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. According to Ellen G. White, I mean the story of Ellen G. White, we know, she was a nobody. Jesus used her to write a lot of books and the messages that needs for us to hear. If we avail ourselves to his calling, if we avail our time, God will use us to do mighty things for his work. What needs to change? What are some of the things that we need to change as a church? Can we be, you know, in the early churches when they were, it's, you know, for us as human beings to change is very hard. We need the Holy Spirit. As it was in the example that was given in the early churches, and I want us to read some of these texts that talks about that. Acts chapter 1 verse 14. Pastor Luke, I know you've been sitting there quietly and I'm giving you a rest because I know you do this every single day. Well, can you please read that for us? Pastor Luke, Acts chapter 1 verse 14. And Connie, can you read Philippians chapter 2 verse, probably just Philippians 2 verse 1, because there's so many texts there. Auntie Daisy, do you have a Bible? And Terry, if you can read Acts chapter 2, and again, it was just this time. Pastor Luke, are you ready?
These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers.
Thank you. Connie? Okay, so there's many texts in that place, but because we don't have the time to do it, I will just thank you, Connie. But if you have time, please go back and read Philippians 2, verses 1 to 20. Desi, do you want to read until Desi Romans 15, verse 6? Romans chapter 15, verse 6. Thank you. And Terry, Acts chapter 2, verse 1. So, all those texts talks about the early churches and how they work together to become one. I believe that Murri-Wantok Church is something that we need. We need to realign our identity, our vision, and our mission with Jesus' identity and Jesus' culture. We need to ask for his support of the Holy Spirit to come into our lives, to help us make the necessary changes so that we can be focused on serving Jesus and Jesus alone. Can someone read John chapter 14, verses 26, please, Glenn? John 14, 26. reading verse 26.
Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you.
Thank you very much. And so that is what we need the Holy Spirit to. It is when we have the Holy Spirit that we will have the discernment to change the things that we as human beings cannot change, but through the working of the Holy Spirit, we should be able to renew our hearts and our minds to be aligned with our Lord and Savior's vision and mission and his identity. Jesus has done so much for us. As you can see, he died on the cross to save us, and that is the reason why we are serving him. He, as sinners, we can only come to him to ask for forgiveness of our sins, and he has promised, as it's found in Isaiah, the one who saved him. It says, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though his sins be scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as white as snow. Jesus is coming back, ready or not. We need to refocus our purpose, our vision, and our lives to serve him and his mission. And I think that is my conclusion, that we've went through so many texts already. We need Christ's identity. And as sinners, we have our shortcomings. But again, in John's 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. We belong to Jesus. Can I ask Miriam to read 1 John chapter 3 and verse 1, which says, we belong to Jesus. 1 John 3 and verse 1. Amen. So we are called by God as his children, and that is who we are and what we are. We have to be overcomers to claim the crown of life. And in order to do that, we need to put on the whole armor of God, which is found in 1 Peter 5, verse 8. Who had the guy asked me? That young lady, yeah, you can. 1 Peter 5 verse 8.
Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour.
Amen. So we need to be sober. Our mind and our heart, as the lesson pointed out, has to be clean so that we can be alert at all times, because the devil is like a roaring lion that prowls around, because his target is to keep him with him and to be in the lake of fire when Jesus comes. The text says in John chapter 14 verse 15, it says, what does it say? If you love me, we are God fearing, and because we love Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we have to keep his commandments. To be 100% ready for his coming, we need to claim his identity, and as sinners, we need to be to do as pointed out in John chapter 1 verse 9. Lastly, we need to obey him and serve him while waiting for his return, or while waiting for his soon return. It is my prayer that we will turn our eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, so the things of his death will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. May God bless us all as we leave this place and think about his message that will help us to repurpose our lives to save him. Amen.